गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वी आर अगेन बैक विद आवर हिस्ट्री एंड पॉलिटिकल साइंस। इन हिस्ट्री एंड पॉलिटिकल साइंस वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट पॉलिटिकल साइंस इन विच वी आर टेकन द फर्स्ट लेसन अबाउट द पोस्ट वर्ल्ड वॉर पॉलिटिकल डेवलपमेंट। वी हैव लर्न अबाउट द फर्स्ट वर्ल्ड वॉर एंड द सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर, एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न समथिंग अबाउट कोल्ड वॉर। Cold War is a period after the First World War and Second World War, which got ended in the year 1919 recently. Okay, what is this Cold War? War, you know, the fight takes place, but Cold War is the war which is within. It is not taken outside in public, means face to face. This is Cold War which is within. Okay, and this Cold War is between which countries? We shall see. America and the Soviet Union, who were allies in the Second World War, became competitors as soon as the war got over. The cooperation between them gave way to rivalry. This rivalry occupied a period of 40 to 45 years of international politics. It is America and Soviet Union, that is Russia. There was no open war between these two countries, but there was such tension in their relations that it seemed that a war would erupt any time. The concept of Cold War is used to describe the condition where there is no actual war, but there are such tensions in the circumstances that they may be responsible to cause war. In this period, America was already a superpower, but the Soviet Union also tried to become a superpower by making nuclear weapons and by increasing its military might. The struggle for power, arms, race, differences in ideologies, attitude of checkmating each other by strategies and counter strategies gave rise to the Cold War. Now, what are the effects of the Cold War? Creation of military organizations. Since it was not actual war and it was just a Cold War, all were busy in building up their military, the defense. Okay, so creation of military organization. During the Cold War, both the superpowers created military organizations. The respective superpowers took up the responsibility of the security of the countries joining the military organizations led by them. NATO, that is North Atlantic Treaty Organization, was a military organization under the dominance of America, while the Warsaw Pact was a military organization under the command of the Soviet Union. So there were two military organizations. One was NATO, that is North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and another was Warsaw Pact, okay, by the Soviet Union. Bipolarization of the world. Second effect of Cold War. Bipolarization of the world means two. Bi means two. Okay. During the Cold War, most countries of the world joined either of the two superpower blocks. Such a division of the nation of the world in two groups is bipolarization. The scope of the Cold War increased due to this. The sphere of tension spread. Okay. The tension spread. Okay. Next is what? Arms race. First is was creation of military organization. Second was bipolarization of the world. World was divided into two. And third is arms race. The superpowers started producing arms on a large scale to outsmart each other. There started a rivalry to make more and more destructive weapons and to acquire the technology required for the same. But soon, both the superpowers realized that the arms race may endanger international peace. Hence, efforts towards arms control and disarmament also happened during this period. Yes, all were busy in having more and more military force with them, more and more weapons. But in this, they forgot that it is always dangerous. And instead of going for war, they had already experienced the two world wars, so they wanted peace. And they started disarmament and arms control. Creation of regional organization. That is also a very much important point. Developing nations created regional organization at the regional level in order to ensure mutual cooperation in the context of the superpower rivalry. They felt that economic development was more important. European countries came together and formed the European Economic Community, while the Southeast Asian countries, Singapore, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Philippines, etc., established the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, that is ASEAN. Okay, they come because for the what you call, we require economic power, no, money is required. So they came and formed two different groups. One became the European group and one became the ASEAN. Okay, Asian countries coming together. One was the European countries coming together and one was the Asian countries coming together. Then came non-alignment. There were some who did not want to take part in both the country, both the powers. They wanted to be separate, non-alignment. In the period of the Cold War, while the world was becoming bipolar, there were some countries which did not want to join the superpower rivalry. Such nations decided to stay out of the Cold War rivalry. Their policy is known as non-alignment. Non-alignment was an important moment during the Cold War. Okay, non-alignment. And the last one is, another one is non-aligned movement. Then Asian and African countries which became independent after the Second World War supported the idea of non-alignment. Means until Second World War they were under the rule of the they were colonies of the rulers, British or whatever this one. But after the Second World War they became independent, and when they became independent they wanted to remain separate. They did not wanted to join any of the groups because they wanted to develop themselves. Okay, the Asian and the African countries which became independent of the Second World War supported the idea of non-alignment. This movement started from 1961 under the leadership of India's Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, President of Yugoslavia Marshal Tito, President of Egypt Gamal Abdel Nasser, President of Indonesia Dr. Sukarno, and Prime Minister of Ghana Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. Okay, these are the people who came and founded that non-alignment movement of Asia and Africa. Then evaluation of the non-alignment movement. Now when this non-alignment movement started, they evaluated. And how they evaluated? The non-aligned movement has opposed colonialism, imperialism and racism. It has encouraged the resolution of international disputes by peaceful means. India led this movement under the guidance of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. India continued to actively support the movement afterwards as well, even after the end of the Cold War. The importance of the movement has not reduced. The non-aligned movement is based on internal principles of humanism, global peace and equality. It has inspired the less developed countries to come together. It has encouraged the resolution of international disputes by peaceful means. While taking a firm stand on disarmament, fostering human rights, the non-aligned movement put forth the problems of poor, undeveloped countries firmly. This movement made a demand of a new international economic order, that is NIO. Summarizing briefly, the significance of the non-aligned movement has not reduced even if the Cold War is over. It inspired the less developed countries to come together. It brought several new streams of economic and social changes into international politics. It gave these countries the confidence to assert themselves with self-respect in international politics. Okay, and then the end of the Cold War. The Cold War had dominated international politics since 1945 came to an end. It was an important event that happened towards the end of the last century. There were many reasons for the end of the Cold War as given below. Now you know, something which starts has to always end. So the Cold War which had started in 1945 also came to an end. And now why it came to an end, what are the reasons for it coming to an end, what are the causes that we shall see. The Soviet Union adopted the policy of opening up the economy. The state loosened up its control of the economy. The then president of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev, implemented the policies of perestroika, that is restructuring, and glasnost, that is openness. Due to these policies, the control over the media reduced. Important changes took place in political and economic spheres, that is these spheres were restructured. This gave impetus to democracy. Third, as the East European countries under the influence of the Soviet Union adopted the capitalist and democratic paths. Capitalist means putting profit, investment, and democratic means, you know, democracy. The regimes there changed. Fourth, the Soviet Union disintegrated and several new nations were created out of it. Russia was the biggest country in the Soviet Union. Okay, that was the reason for the formation of end of the Cold War. Now, after ending the Cold War, what is that? That is the post-Cold War world. The Cold War came to an end with the disintegration of the Soviet Union, which till then had been a superpower. As a result, major changes took place in world politics. For example, America remained the only superpower in world politics. Now only one power is, that is America. A conducive atmosphere prevailed for the growth in trade and economic relations between and among nations. Capital, labor, market and information circulated throughout the world. Ideas spread freely as well. As all nations of the world decided to give priority to trade relations, the idea of giving aid to other nations fell behind. Instead, efforts began to be made to establish economic relations. The descriptions of a country which was opposed to another has now changed from enemy nation to rival nation. The responsibility of the United Nations has increased. The United Nations now had to take more concrete steps to maintain global peace and security. Environmental protection, fostering of human rights, gender equality, and management of natural calamities now acquired a global dimension. Now you see, the whole idea changed. The whatever intentions were there earlier, whatever they were given importance, have changed, and now different things are given importance, which is of more of greater importance. Earlier, petty things were given more importance about war and rivalry and all, but now global issues, important issues, were given more importance. Now, what is globalization? After the end of the Cold War, trade and economic relations between countries became more open, as been mentioned before. Capital, labor, markets and information began circulating globally. The give and take of ideas among people all over the world grew. Due to the revolution in information technology, different events and developments began to be known everywhere. The boundaries between nations did not remain as sacrosanct as they were before. All these processes are together called globalization. Just as globalization has brought us benefits, it has also caused losses. Okay, globalization has brought the world together, but it has also had caused losses. Now, what are there? For example, as the economies of different countries got linked with each other, trade increased, economic unification grew, plenty of products became available in the markets, but at the same time, the gap between the poor and the rich nations did not reduce. Poor became poor, rich became rich. In this chapter, we studied the global development from 1945 onwards. We understood the world in the Cold War period, the arms race, and the efforts at disarmament. We also learned about the meaning of globalization. In the next chapter, we shall study India's foreign policy. Thank you, students. Please complete the questions, write down the answers, and study this lesson. Okay? Soon we are going to begin with the exam first unit test. So please prepare yourself for your exam. Thank you.